Thank you very much. First of all, I would really like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to share some of my experiences and thoughts. We've been studying the inland waterways, particularly in some detail over the last 2.5 years, primarily because I work with a small NGO which is interested in water and rivers and trying to understand the intersection of development, environment, and water. So how best we can use our water resources for meeting our developmental needs, at the same time looking at the environment through a prism of equity, sustainability, both. So for us, this is really a very important opportunity, great learning experience, and I hope that I will also be able to share some of the concerns and issues that we feel are important as we talk about the use of rivers for navigation and transport. Particularly in the new context, because we know, of course, that navigation transport in inland waterways has been going on for centuries, but we are trying to now do things more in a different way, at a greater speed, greater scale. So these are some of the changes which are taking place, and within that, what are the concerns and challenges, issues, is something that I want to talk about. Of course, I don't think I can highlight more than a few of the key concerns, but at least I want to try and talk about a couple of important ones. Also, I want to say that since yesterday, I've been hearing some of the talks. And one thing, as a researcher, as an analyst, and as an activist who's involved in looking at environment, I found it very interesting, and I was very happy to hear the voices which talked about, and in so many words, that the blue economy is not just about economic activity around water, but it is economic activity around water with the aim of also sustainability built in. And there was a talk of respecting and restoring health of the oceans, of our water bodies. So I think this is very, very important for us as an approach, that while we use the water resources in many different ways, it's very important for us to be concerned about the health of the water bodies, be it the oceans, the estuaries, or the rivers. I think it's very heartening to hear those voices. And to that, I may add, not just the health of the water bodies, but the health and well-being of the communities which are dependent on those water bodies and those water systems. I think it's a very, very critical issue. So that approach, I think, is very heartening to hear about it. But, and there's always a but, unfortunately, what is happening outside this halls, what is happening out there, is completely different. Particularly when I talk about the inland waterways, what we are seeing is that work on the waterways is going on in a way that is badly affecting the environment. It is not at all being done with a view to, you know, do it in a sustainable manner. It is having, and it is likely to have, large adverse impacts both on the environment as well as on the communities around it. And why this is so is what sort of I want to try and talk about. Also, I want to say that we have heard there have been a number of claims. When we talk about the inland waterways, it's always preceded or followed by the use of the words cheap and environment friendly. But I would like to say here that that in many cases, it's really not cheap, or at least not the cheapest option, particularly both because of reasons which are located within the waterway but also located outside, the last mile connectivity, door-to-door related issues, and several others. So it's not, in many cases, it is not the cheapest option, and in almost never is it environment friendly. This is what I want to say. And why? So I think that one of the things that is there, it is buried deeply within our entire outlook and approach to how we look at natural resources. When we look at a river, we see it as an opportunity, as a potential, as a business opportunity. And I'm not saying it in a bad way. You know, maybe it is, oh, it is offering an opportunity to transport or to build a dam or to do this. But, and that is true. I'm not denying that that's not true. But a river has many dimensions. It has many aspects. It's not one thing. This is one aspect. At the same time, we must understand and respect that a river is an ecological entity. It's a living ecological entity that is sustaining the rest of the ecosystem around us, not just the human civilization. It is sustaining and has to sustain, and it's a part and parcel of the entire ecosystem. A river has religious links, social links, cultural links, especially if you go to the northeast and also in many of the tribal areas, there is a very, very strong identity association with rivers that the people there have. So a river is a multifaceted thing. And if we lose sight of that, then we are really going to run into problems because we end up treating these things as a commodity. Same thing with forests, same thing with other natural resources. So I think there is a need to, first of all, when we look at that, shift our perspective in a more holistic way. That is the first thing. Second thing is, I think we must understand that when we talk about, and at least this is my understanding, I may be wrong, there are many other knowledgeable people I can be corrected, but when we talk about river transport being environment friendly, at the core somewhere is the environment friendliness comes essentially because it uses less fuel, so in that sense it is environment friendly. Maybe you don't have to cut a path through a forest or something like that, maybe that's why it's environment friendly. But whatever may be some dimensions of the environment friendliness of a waterway through a river, we must understand that there are other significant adverse impacts that it can have on the environment. Creating, developing, maintaining, and operating a waterway in a river has many activities which have significant environmental impact. I think we know all of it, so I don't have to get into it, the details, but dredging itself is something which disrupts the habitat, the natural habitat of a river, sometimes even damages it. Dredging and the operation of waterways leads to turbidity, to increased noise, a leakage of oil and lubricants. Then, of course, we have channelization often happening in the river, river protection works. All of this has a lot of impact on the entire river ecosystem. And of course, on fish, just to take one part of that, because it ties up directly to the communities which depend on the river. In fact, one of the biggest impacts, I would say, of creating and operating waterways in rivers and also in estuarine areas, in coastal areas, particularly estuarine areas which are very, very rich grounds for fish, is the impact it has on fish. You know, the turbidity, the habitat is destroyed, the turbidity and the noise makes the fish go away from that area. When you want to run larger vessels, then large number of restrictions are put on fisher people. You can't operate at certain times. You can't put your net here. You can't do this. Sometimes they lose their nets, which are cut away. So all of this has big impacts. Just to give you two quick examples from two ends of India. Dharamtar Creek, which is now being developed as Waterway, National Waterway 10, but it has been operating as a waterway for a long time. And when we visited there, what we found, what the fisher people were telling us, is that we are completely at our wits and we are completely frustrated in our daily fights with the barges and the dredgers. We are just not able to fish here. The fish are going away from this area. The breeding grounds of the fish are being destroyed. And it's not a small number. There are some 3,000 or 3,500 fishing boats and vessels and, you know, families there. Similarly, earlier this month when one of our team visited Brahmani and Paradip Port and Mahanadi, because it is being developed as part of Waterway 5, because nothing is happening there, but the fisher people there, when you know, we discussed with them that these are the likely kind of activities that will happen there, they were aghast. They said, "Aaj raat ko hum soenge nahi, ye jo aapne bataya hai." Now, there are two important aspects here. One is, of course, that the fisher people, and they themselves then shared, you know, why these activities create a problem. The dredging will also lead to more saltwater ingress. They were worried, changing the balance, destroying the breeding grounds. So many things. They only told us all these likely impacts. And so, you know, what is the impact of all this is likely to happen on the fishing communities is a area of concern. But the other area of concern is that they had no idea that all this was going to happen. We are trying to build these whatever you want to call them, waterways or these transport logistic arrangements, but we have not bothered to discuss with the local population. They are not involved, they are not informed, they are not consulted. And these are some of the people who are having the biggest impacts. This is not the way to go ahead with something which is going to have such a big impact on these populations. Anyway, so the point is that one of the big concerns that we have is that developing and maintaining and operating these waterways is going to have a huge impact on the fish and on the fishing community, apart from some of the other ecological impacts, which I'm not getting into right now, but there are several of them. How can something which has such a huge impact on some of the most vulnerable communities, some of the poorer communities in this country, how can we call it cheap? That's a question I would like to pose. How can we call it cheap? Yes, I understand that when we use the word it's a cheap mode of transport, we are essentially referring to maybe just one part, that the fuel cost is less compared to others. And I'm not, again, not to discount that, but I'm saying that we must take a larger view. Yesterday, somebody, I think, Mr. Naik, you only talked about how we need to look at the net impact. I don't know who was it. Somebody, I think, very, very important. When we look at and assess the impact of any developmental intervention, then we must look at the net impact, the positives, negatives, and what is the totality. This, what is happening to the fish and fishing community, is one of the things which has to go into the net impacts of a waterway. But when we look at a net impact, then I think there is another dimension to it. We cannot just do an algebraic totaling. Of course, it's not even possible. There are so many things you can't compare, but you know, leaving aside those things, an impact assessment is not just even a comprehensive impact assessment is not simply about the totaling, algebraic totaling of all the impacts. What is also important is that whether the people at the receiving end of the benefits and the impacts, if they are different, then you can't total it. If the benefits are large and the adverse impacts are low, still, if they are accruing to different communities, different people, then you cannot total them. Then your entire development planning must include how the people who are adversely affected, how they will be compensated, mitigated. Is there any way to handle it? Unfortunately, we are not seeing any of that happen today in the entire planning and execution of the waterways project there. Now, the question is, why? Because, you know, it's a very common thing. All these projects have to, you know, do environment impact assessment and everything. So surely they must be looking at all these factors. Unfortunately, the answer is no. At least not in any meaningfully credible manner or a legally binding manner. And that's the other concern which I want to pose before all of you. We know very well that most of the developmental interventions in this country require an environmental clearance. And the assessment of social and environmental impacts of large developmental interventions is governed essentially in this country by the EIA notification issued by Ministry of Environment in 2006. That's the EIA notification 2006. Of course, there are other parameters, some of the other legislations also, but primarily the primary assessment is done under this. The EIA notification 2006 says that a certain list, they give a list, all these developmental interventions, it's a dam, it's a factory, whether it's a whatever smelter, etc., there's a long list. When you do any or all of these things, then it is incumbent for you to get a prior environmental clearance before you do any work on it. Now, this list, which is a schedule to the notification, does not list waterways. Probably because it was built at a time when it was not really thought. That list was created in 2006, or actually even earlier, 94. It's a relic of 94, but you know, so how the legacy issues get built in every little thing. It doesn't list waterways, but in an amendment in 2009, dredging and ports was included in it. Now, all of us know that you cannot have a waterway mostly without dredging. So if you talk about any waterway, at least the dredging component would be there. So therefore, most of the waterways would, at least some elements of that would be covered under an environment impact assessment procedure under this EIA notification. Unfortunately, that is not happening. And what is happening instead, what we are seeing is a very, very clear attempt to evade the environmental clearance for waterways. And that's something which, again, I want to share with you. And this is something which we have pieced together through a series of documents obtained under the Right to Information Act over 1.5 years. So somewhere, I think, 2016-2017, the Ministry of Environment, under this EIA notification, started asking the waterway, wherever the work was going on, to seek environmental clearance. So the Goa waterways, which you mentioned, I think 111, 68, and 27, that's the national waterway numbers. They went to the Ministry of Environment and got the terms of reference to do the EIA impact assessment. National Waterway 5 was doing it also. Things changed when the Ganga waterways turn came, probably because it's a prestigious project, probably because whatever may be the reasons for it. When the Ganga waterway came up for environment clearance, Ministry of Environment said very clearly, this needs, you need to get an environment clearance for this project. Ministry of Shipping and the IWAI started saying that, no, we don't need environment clearance for this. And the whole thing went back and forth, back and forth. And one could clearly see an escalation on the pressure on Ministry of Environment for it to give exemption to this project. The reasoning was very specious. First thing they said is that this is only maintenance dredging, what we are doing in Ganga. It's not capital dredging, so we don't require environment clearance. Actually, that's completely false, because the entry in the EIA notifications does say dredging, and then there is a special elaboration of that which says maintenance dredging shall be exempted from clearance if it has already been presented for clearance as a part of the original proposal of capital dredging. Otherwise, it has to take. This reason was given. Then some other reasoning was given, that there is a sand mining guidance rules which were actually given so that, you know, river dredging or sand mining from river is, you know, how that is to be governed. There are only guidelines, but that exempts waterways. A guideline cannot overrule a notification. So without going into the details, this thing sort of went back and forth. Then Ministry of Environment actually put up the issue to its expert committee that what should we do about it. The expert committee, which gives a guidance on what part should be covered under the environment clearance, what should be not, and all that. And this committee was headed by Dr. S.R. Vate, and they gave a very, very unambiguous, absolutely clear recommendation. I would just take a minute to read that. That meeting, which was held in May 2017, says, and there the Inland Waterways Authority made a detailed presentation of their site, so it was, you know, they considered all that. After detailed deliberations during the meeting, the committee clarified that the proposal for implementation of Jalmarg Vikas project, that is the Ganga waterway, is covered under the EIA notification 2006 and be appraised as a category A project with reference to specific issues addressing river as living entity, changing hydrology, riparian rights, transboundary impacts, protection of banks and floodplain zones of the river system. Also, maintenance dredging involved in this project cannot be exempted from environment clearance, as the project has not obtained any prior environment clearances provided in the notification, etc. Then they also go beyond that and say, in order to bring more clarity regarding the applicability of such projects under the EIA notification, the expert committee recommended for amending the notification to include inland waterways, jetties, and multimodal terminals under the list requiring prior environmental clearance. So they said, just to be very sure, this should be done. But ultimately, it seemed that the pressure was built up. And in October, soon after this meeting, in October, there was a meeting between the Minister for Shipping and Water Resources and the Minister for Environment, in which, again, Ministry of Environment said that, no, our stand remains the same. But the meeting surprisingly concluded. So everybody has now agreed that Ganga waterway will not need the environment clearance. And according to that, Ministry of Environment issued a letter in December 2017. Now, how this has happened, if you look at the document, it's a completely legally untenable reasoning, but one can clearly see certain pressures at work. Unfortunately, what this has also meant now is that this has become a precedent. So now, Brahmaputra waterway work is going on, Barak waterway work is going on. They have not bothered to seek the environment clearance. And National Waterway 5, which had already been given the terms of reference and which had been, which was going in for clearance and the EIA was being done under the EC process, has now written to the ministry saying that in light of this, exemption should be granted to us also. So this is now a clear attempt at taking out the entire waterway sector from the environment clearance legal regime. Interestingly, another argument which is being given by the waterways authority is that, okay, we are asking for exemption from the environment clearance process, which is the legally binding process, but we are not neglecting the environment. We are doing EIS for each and every project, and we are doing all that. But there is a big difference for an EIA which is done by the project and an EIA and an assessment process which is done under the environment clearance legal regime. Very, very clear. Under the EIA notification, there is a committee called the Expert Appraisal Committee, which is constituted by the Ministry of Environment, which has not just officials, but it also has non-official members, independent members. It is the Expert Appraisal Committee which issues the terms of reference under which the EIA is done. And then after the EIA is done and public hearing is held, the Expert Appraisal Committee scrutinizes the EIA. Whereas an EIA which is being done right now by the IWAI essentially is the project promoter who's doing the EIA, setting his or her own terms of reference, and he's the only one who's again scrutinizing the EIA. This is a clear conflict of interest. Second, when an EC is given by the Ministry of Environment under the EIA notification, then it's a legally binding document with several conditions which are legally binding. If the project does not implement those conditions, then very clearly it's a violation, legal violation, and even an ordinary citizen can get a judicial remedy for that. They can go to the NGT or they can go to the court and get that implemented. Whereas right now, it's at the discretion of the project promoter and he can do whatever he wants and nobody's legally responsible, not legally binding. In short, the entire environment impact assessment and environment safeguard process now that is going on with the inland waterways project in the country has very little accountability and very little credibility. This is a very, very sorry state of affairs because unfortunately, this is going to just create more risk for the projects. This is going to create the risks of people protesting and, you know, all sort of things escalating. And even if it does not, it is just bad practice. It is not something that we should be proud of. Whatever it is, we should do a comprehensive... Yeah, thank you. I'm the first speaker who has been told that we are running out of time in this entire 2 days. So that's also a privilege.
I am going to drop off my talk altogether.
I thank you. I agree. But I'm just saying that since yesterday, as part of the audience, we have been listening to whatever time is given to the speakers. So, but anyway, it's the chair's prerogative. And I'll end up in just 2 minutes. So basically, it's not something that we should be proud of. And it's going to create a lot of problems. So therefore, in the end, what I would like to say is if we really want to see waterways being... and I think there is a role for the river navigation and river navigation systems. But if they are done in a very different way. And that is something which I have not gone into, but I would mention that the waterways which are being developed in the navigation, first and foremost, must have a connect with the local communities. Connect in two ways. They should first serve the needs of the local communities. Today we are talking about large containers, large cargoes, large bulk transport of fly ash and coal. The local communities stand on the bank and watch that going. Are their transport and navigation needs being met? How is this going to work? I think that should be the first thing that should happen. Second is, in the entire planning process, there should be meaningful involvement of the local communities, particularly those who are going to be very directly affected. Their involvement should be there in the entire planning process, in the entire decision-making process about how the waterway is to be developed and how it is to be planned and executed. Third, definitely with all its problems, there are a lot of problems in the current way the environment clearance process is set up. There are a lot of problems, but with all its problems, it's a important and fairly well-developed system. Therefore, inland waterways must be brought under the ambit of the EIA notification 2006. These are some of the steps which I will say as a first step towards a more credible execution of the waterways, inland waterways navigation project in a manner that at least they stand a chance of being environmentally sustainable, equitable, and really serving the needs.